end of the exam, press the delete button, your memory is as fresh as before. That's not really learning. So I think the learning has to be exploration based. So innovation has to be part of that game. Today, innovation is used in a very technical way, that's commercial. But I'm actually using it as a free English word, innovation. And exploration-driven learning is always fun. And when you are having fun with doing something, as learners should, then that is true learning. And then excellence is the way forward. So when you discover your passion, you're likely to excel in it. So I think with this introduction, let me request the panelists one by one to share their thoughts on these two points. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. I am Dr. K. S. Murthy. I am the provost of ITM Vocational University. I started my career as a banker for 20 years, and I was in the securities market for 10 years. My academic journey is for the last 10 years as the director of ITM Institute of Financial Markets, but right now the provost of ITM Vocational University. With the rich experience in the industry, the other side of the academy, have come to the other side of the requirement of learning, that is the academics. So there are several gaps existing in the current education system, both at lower level, even higher education level. There needs to be a lot of changes needed. Keeping that in view, being the provost of ITM Vocational University, we are mandated to integrate the skill training into the higher education space. This was a really challenging for me, and it was a good experience for me also. The students come with a lot of expectations, a lot of legacy that they carry from the schools. My observation is that the schools, the fundamental things of the behavior or the social aspects are missing in many ways. But today, I am addressing the futuristic schools. You all of us have attended to that fundamental thing of behavior and the social aspect of social skills and behavioral skills that were not, you being a futuristic school, you must have taken it. And the topic of today is the research, innovation, and entrepreneurship. All the three are interlinked with each other. As Madam was telling, the creativity, the creation of ideas and solutions, and thereon the critical thinking, questioning their ideas, questioning their solutions, come out with their rationale about their future, and communication. These three are very important, and the innovation and entrepreneurship is the vehicle for innovation. So the first thing is the research, innovation, and entrepreneurship. It goes together. If entrepreneurial education is practiced at the school level, at the university level, most of the things will be taken care of, the research aspect, the innovation aspect, and the entrepreneurial aspect. Even though go for the job, the industry or company looks at the intrapreneurial skills of the candidate. What he wins at the end of the day with his contribution to the company. As an entrepreneur, he wants to bring in the add-ons or value additions, system improvement, efficiencies into the system. So this is the crux of this one, entrepreneurial education, that is to be introduced right from the schools in a disguised manner, covering all the aspects of the research, innovation, and education. When I look at you, all are being the futuristic schools. I visualize the future of learning will be unprecedented. It is because the unprecedented opportunities are there going to come, unprecedented disruptive innovations and technologies are going to come. Right now, the 45% of activities for which the employees are paid are going to be substituted by the automation with the established technology. If that being the scenario, the skills that are required to be something different, they would suit to the changing environment and changing technology. So the disruptive innovation, disruptive technology that is taking place in the marketplace create new jobs and old jobs will go away. And for the, these people right from the schools, they should be focusing into the their future, their life, the skills for their life, and skill for the future-proof careers. So all these will be, in a nutshell, to be groomed from the schooling stage itself. By the time they come to the higher education, there will be only learning will take place. The spoon feeding, whatever is that is happening, it should be in the primary school level only. Even in the upper primary school, also the spoon feeding would go away. It should be learning. The students should start learning with the assistance and the help of the teacher. That should happen. And the future schools will be different. The way the teaching that is going to be different. And the as Madam was telling, for this innovation and entrepreneurship, risk-taking culture should be developed. The appropriate risk-taking capacity to be built into the candidate right from the day one, and encourage the creativity, don't stop it. And these are the things that is required, and for this to establish, it is the all the stakeholders need to add to that. Maybe the there should be a physical infrastructure, there should be digital infrastructure in place in the schools to match to the future learning. And there should be appropriate teachers with the proper training, continuous professional development should be there to match to the future requirement. And the curricular development should also be made in such a way involving a design thinking into it. That is the curriculum development or the curating the syllabus. All these things should be done with a design thinking of the group of stakeholders involved in that. And the student first should be taken care in the teaching and learning things. Students nowadays are well versed with the technology and the online pedagogy. So the inputs from the students should also be taken for developing the future learning environment. So these are the things I think that is required for the future. And the students of today, one research study says that those who are entering into the primary education, 65% of them enter into the jobs which are not existing now. That means the skills going to differ, the skills, competencies, knowledge level going to differ as days progress. So the children in the schools should be taught about the skills to handle the future risks. So if the base, the gone are the base, the people working in the same organization all through. Now the things are that the job profiles are changing, the expectations are changing, and they need to change at least their lifetime, maybe a dozen jobs, dozen careers. So every career you should add on lifelong learning. Lifelong learning should be incorporated into the curricula, so that is future life, future career is proof from all the development, disruptions, innovations that are taking place in the marketplace. So the foundation should be laid in the schools, and at higher education level, they should take up to the finishing level. With these words, I hand over the
speech. Thank you so much. I think we are all in agreement with that. And now let me ask a focused question, because given your huge technology advantage, the thing that we are talking about is that one size does not fit all. So differentiated learning experience that technology can, because you know, when a teacher is actually lecturing, everybody is being exposed to the same time t equal to zero. But if I'm in front of the computer, I can pause it, rewind, re-listen, and then sort of have the pace tuned to my own need. But it's much more than just the pace. It's actually the content that has to be suitable. So if you could touch upon that, taking into account from what we have been discussing, that innovation and not rote learning is should be the method. So how technology can help us and enable the teachers to.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, so my two learned colleagues have said a lot of quality stuff. Anything I add would basically be a repetition of what has already been said. So it is my turn to tell you a story. So the story goes back 26 years. And thanks to my mentors and my teachers, you know, credit does not go to me, but to all of them. They taught us how to learn. So Dr. Ajay Babu at St. Peter's College in Agra and Vishi, my first job in Delhi. Now, Dr. Ajay Babu always used to ask me, and he had, you know, 8 years work experience in Steel Authority of India before he came to teach. So he used to ask us why. So if potassium permanganate is purple, why is it purple? You know, so why do you accept that it is purple? Why is it not white? Why is it not green? So I said, before you touch potassium permanganate, you know, don't mix it in water, purify water, clean water. No, why is it purple? Why is it crystalline? So this basic small stuff. Okay, salt. Take it in a spoon, heat it over a candle, and you'll see a you know, the salt jumping out of the spoon and create a nice fountain. Enjoy the fountain. So I did the same thing. I went home, created a perfume. It was actually ammonia. I made my mom smell it. It was thrown out of the house. But actually, the same thought process, you know, at Vishi Anand and Puneet VAP Enterprises, 26 years ago, when Standard Chartered Bank launched the credit card in India, the credit card was, you know, carrying a card, a plastic card was the driver. So they launched a service, 41 services for your house. Electricity bill, power bill, and in those days, you know, getting the water bill done was half a day's job. You had to go and stand in the line. Electricity bill, half a day more. So 200 rupees, 41 services for your house, and they give you a VAP card. And the card would not sell. Because people would negotiate on 200 rupees. And it was Delhi, and they were servicing entire Delhi. So a person would come from Pusa Road, come to your house in GK1, collect your bill, collect your money, deposit it, give it back to you, 41 services. Dry cleaning, laundry, and it would still not work. 6 months, there came a day where we had to shut down. And we said, okay, either we are going to find a problem, or we are going to shut it down tomorrow morning. And 2 nights, all of us sat in the office. And I was just a young guy. So we said, let us look at people, let's look at process, let's look at technology. The problem was people. Everywhere we would go, the society president said, mere ko free mein de do. I'll get you the introductions. Secretary would say, mere ko free mein de do. And it continued like this. But what we decided was, if they want to negotiate, we are not going to let them negotiate on the pricing. It was already rock bottom, 200 bucks a month. So we said, 200 rupees, 15 services, and choose your 15 services. And now people would not negotiate on 200, but they would say, 15, okay, no, give me 20, because this is what I need more. Somebody would say, give me 21. The society president would say, give me all 41. I'm the president. So that behavior issue actually helped us, and see, we managed that. That is where we were wrong. We had given too much. So that particular behavior that we drove, that company went on to become a 3 crore rupee company in those days, and it was sold to one of the advertising companies. Those 2 nights spent. Now at MIT, when I was doing this entrepreneurship program, the same thought. These guys, Hershey's, came to us and they said chocolate, and they want to get into the health domain. The health business. We know chocolate has a lot of benefits, but it has a lot of sugar that comes along with it. And they tried fake chocolate, they tried fake sugar, they tried bleached bread, and everything that they tried at MIT could not succeed because people would reject the taste. So when they gave me that project as a part of my entrepreneurship program, I said, listen, make a chocolate cake, put more sugar, more chocolate, more bread, load it up. But what you do is the box, the mold, shape it into ribs. And every chop in that rib is 360 calories. So now there is no guilt of eating chocolate. One chop is 360 calories. You know what you are eating. You know the quantity. You know it is 100% clean chocolate. You are eating loads of sugar. There is no need to, there are no withdrawal symptoms. And I got a 96% on my assignment. And I got the certification. There's one more thing that I learned there. Passing marks was 80%. In our case, passing marks is 33%, 40%. Why? Why? You know, we talk of research, innovation. We unnecessarily try and teach the student 12 subjects, 10 subjects. Passing marks 33%. Teach him 4 subjects. Passing marks have to be 80% minimum. See, if you don't even know 80% of a subject, 33% you promote them to the next class and then they expect them to do well in the next class. Again, you give 33% next class. Again, you say he will do well in the next class. Right? 33% of a subject you know and you say he is good to go. That is where the problem is. And I'll give you the same example. I told my son the same thing. My son used to get 70% marks, but he is very good in computers. So I put three of my kids, cousins, first cousins kids through Princeton, 100% scholarship. Exactly the same thought. Now my son said, I am going to do computer science, and he got two universities. One was UBC, the other was Conflent. Now Conflent is a polytechnic institute, has a joint program with UBC. 2 years at Conflent, 2 years at UBC. So he went to Conflent. The difference is, at Conflent, it is only hands-on. In the first year, in computer science, they don't teach you physics, chemistry, and mathematics. They teach you derivative mathematics. Now, the last time when we were here on a similar program with Rethink, I said, we don't need your BTECs in electrical, electronics, it's dead. You need a BTEC in Google. And honestly, if you take a BTEC in Google and a BSc in Google and a BA in Google and a BCom in Google, that will take care of your people issues, your process issues, your content issues, the technical issues. You can write algorithms. See, today, as Mr. Majumdar was saying, digital is, you can see a plateau. See, Flipkart and Snapdeal had the same technology. Why is it that one is trying to buy the other one? They have the same technology, same amount of money, same amount of cash burn rate. It is the content and the people. So honestly speaking, like we have AR coming in today. Right? AR is when you can put our glasses in front of your eyes and a 3D picture. These kids get these 7D games. Huh? So AR, you can actually configure and program that you can walk down the Taj Mahal with Shahenshah and Mumtaz Begum and see what Birbal was saying and what Shahjahan was saying and what Akbar was saying. You can actually configure that. And a student sees that video interface once. You don't have to tell him to read a history book. Because he's going to get the essence of the entire game plan. Amar Chitra Katha. We have dumped it. You just need to convert it into AR. Augmented reality. Now, if you keep on telling your kids, no, go back to the books. My 7-year-old, 10-year-olds refuse. And quite frankly, my son who was at 70% here is at 97% marks. Because, whatever he loves is what he's actually got. So class 7th onwards, honestly, CBSC, they start introduction to computers. Class 10th, they do C. Class 11th and 12th, they do Java. I don't think they need Hindi and Sanskrit, as mandatory subjects. No. And I'll give you a small example. 23 years ago, computers came to the world. Broad-based, commercial computing. Japan was the number one country in electronics manufacturing. So Japan economy should have gone up. But 23 years ago, Japan went into a recession. And even till date, 0%, plus 0.1, 1, minus 1, 23 years. Why? And they were the world number one in electronics manufacturing. So you know, this thought process with our kids, and quite honestly, I'm not an engineer, I'm a digital commerce guy. But I have 99 patents to my name. I developed 1648 patents at GE Aircraft. All of them funded. Now the only reason was, think through. So in my physiotherapy course at my university, and my optometry course, a BSc optometry never used to sell. It used to go blank every year. I said, listen, you've got these glasses, and you know Moore's law. Things change after a certain quantum of time. So, sir, you've had these glasses for the last 200 years. Kitna change aaya hai? What is the percentage of change? So 10, 15, 20% plastic ho gaya hai, non-breakable ho gaya hai. But the same mathematics remains. But you've got this device in your pocket. If you put this in front of your eye, you've got computing in front of you. Now look at the quantum. So the power of this camera is the power of your eye. And today, the weakest part of your body is your eyes. Pollution, light, noise, all the stuff. Your eyes are the weakest. The maximum risk. So if you can cover your eyes with a camera, a processing device, and it's already there in your pocket. You've got the screen, you've got the camera, all the processing software in the middle, right? You don't need glasses. It will have vision correction. It will have all the filters, everything that you need. It also has digital information coming in. And you've already seen that happen in Iron Man 8 years ago. Right? So the glasses have to go. So we're already working on the device. Almost complete. The problem is, the resolution of the screen is the challenge. That is what is stopping us from commercially bringing it out. So it is always about people, process, and technology. But I'll tell you, sir, a lot of our focus is on technology. We take IT, doctors, we forget about people. And that is where we as Indians take a hit when it comes to dealing with a lot of the outsiders. Language competence is low. Low self-esteem. The reason, the confidence to, you know, ask why, again and again, keep on asking why. We don't do that, we accept it. So this education segment that we have, all our teachers, they should, before they come and teach in your school, you should not take a B.Ed. teacher. You should take a teacher who has spent 5 years having worked in the bank. You don't want a lady, you know, honestly, who has only done a B.Ed. and come and teach in a school. 5 years in the bank, it will show you what is their real competence. 5 years in a private enterprise will show you what is their real competence. And then they come and teach. That is the only step that you need to take. Anybody that you hire, or at least 50% of the people you hire, should have at least 5 years of private enterprise experience. Because they will understand what is delivery. The reason why I say this, I was one of the senior boys at Infosys. At Infosys, the biggest challenge was the quality model. How do you bring in Six Sigma, PDCA, Malcolm Baldrige model, and all this stuff? You know, you are doing Java, sir, she is doing C, he is doing some project in the UK, that gentleman is doing some project in the Netherlands. How do I build the quality model? They could never do that. And that is why Infosys never invested on Six Sigma. And my take to Nandan was, boss, even if they fail, they will still know what Six Sigma is. Today, they don't even understand the concept. So therefore, anybody that you hire for your school, the only criteria should be 5 years of core industry experience. If you've done it, then you come and teach it. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That's a provocative presentation. I think every point we could debate and then come up with maybe a slightly different answer. One thing for sure is that the point is well taken, that how do you select the best teachers to do the kind of thing? And there's a catch that I could easily see, and I'm sure some of you have caught it, that if we are saying that the future is going to have jobs that today we cannot even predict, then if you have a fixed skill set for which you train your students and do not give them the wherewithal to do, engineers for me are not just engineers, they're problem solvers. And you cannot be a problem solver if you do not know the context of the problem. The context of the problem therefore means that even an engineer or a technical person should know societal parameters and the behavior that you're talking about. And many are actually implementing that context of the problem as important as solving and giving them the tools. What is needed for the futuristic schools that we are talking about today is in this context. This is very, very clear that if you just give them fixed tool set and not the thinking power, be it in history or Hindi or Sanskrit or English, the thinking power to derive from the past to make a step in the future, they would all fail, because the jobs we are seeing in the market today are not going to be in existence, most of them, 10 years from now. So I think this is the point, that the learning, if we bring the learner back at the center, which it should be, we do not ask the question anymore whether you are a great teacher. The question I ask is that whether your students have learned. So whatever it takes to make the learning process enjoyable, and therefore your students to learn, what is to be learned is, there is nothing called that I prepare you for the future. All I enable you to do is to think and practice with your hands. And for that, I think it's a very, very provocative thought that what kind of teachers should our school system have to enable them to have this. And one comment I have on that is that it cannot be that you have a 5-year experience in some job and you come. Teachers have to be lifelong learners themselves, because it's a continuous upgradation of your skills. That's the need of the future. The kind of exposure he's talking about, I think we should really look at it. And where we feel today is teaching is your last preference. We want the stars to go. Stars meaning word driven. I don't mean intellectual stars, I mean 5 best publications in the world. But point is that when you're driven, teaching jobs should be your first priority. Unfortunately, it is not. And that's where the problem is. Again, it's not a process of selection, but eliminating every other job possibilities, teachers go there. And there, I think, if we could have a policy paper to change the way the country has been thinking about school teaching. Because I think the best people should be school teachers, because then only from there the country's future is secure. So with that thought, maybe I ask we're running a little late, maybe we'll come back with the question answer time. Let's finish with the panelists and then we'll take up some questions.
Thank you, Chairman. I don't know why Dr. Sufi met me here. I wouldn't call myself an education expert or education technologist. I'm basically a scientist. I do a lot of science. I'm an old man, I still do science. But having come here, I would like to say a couple of words. I studied in a village school, in a remote village school in a Tamil medium. I started learning the ABCD at the 6th standard. And the whole of 6th standard, I was writing only ABCD, nothing else. Well, I passed an SSLC and 5 women sent me to college. I said, yeah, elder brother is studying, I can't afford 2 people studying in college, just stay at home, to cover the lines. I fought with my father, finally my mother came to my rescue. Well, let me not go into all that story. All that I'm trying to tell you is, I am what I am today because of my teachers in the school. There are a couple of teachers, one is Alfred Pike and another one is Sevenan. They inspired me a lot. But for them, I wouldn't be what I am today. Ultimately, at the end of the day, it's the teacher who matters. All of us know, I mean, whatever methodology you have, whatever technology you have, the teaching method, all that you have, unless the teacher is inspired or motivated teacher is there, nothing can be done. Well, having said it, most part of my life I've been practicing science and technology. In fact, it would not be exaggeration if I say science and technology gave me the tools to be what I am today. It gave me pride to bring pride to me and to my family. Science and technology taught me a great deal of discipline, teamwork, interpersonal relationship. So I'm a strong believer in science and technology. I believe science and technology is the key to just a digital world. Today, science and technology. I am what I am today because of science and technology. Science and technology eliminate elitism. Science and technology brings two socially, culturally, economically different society to the same population. So I am a strong believer in science and technology. Having said it, however much science and technology that we have, see, in the school education, teaching methodology, books and all that, again I'll come back to the same one. Let me go to that here. Somebody mentioned here about, we go back to Gurukul system. Gurukul system, I don't know. I'm in a pharmacy store, do a lot of drugs discovery method. People tell me, sir, let's go back to Ayurveda. Ayurveda has been there for the past 5,000 years. But Ayurveda, don't touch the formulations. Formulations have been developed 5,000 years back. Let us adopt, use Ayurveda as such. You see, science grows, technology grows, society advances. They said, no, don't touch the Ayurveda formulation. Let us use it as such. For me, telling that let's go back to Guru Granth system looks like let us not touch a system that has been developed 5,000 years back. I wouldn't agree with that. Well, I won't go take much of your time. Thank you very much, sir.
Okay. So I think we have time for a couple of questions from the audience.
On the lunch, we can take it across.
Just take, I think you also have a point to make. If there is some quick comments, questions.
I have just a small question. It's not a question, it's a concern. Okay, this is a question, a query coming out from a parent. Don't consider me into an educational panel. My concern is we talk about choices, we talk about jobs, we talk about employability and futures of Google and Yahoo's. Pertaining to my relationship with my own child, I today don't know what she wants to become, and either she knows. Why is the education system in India still does not assessing candidates or the students on the aspiration or the career interest? And maybe she wants to become a copy Justin Bieber, or had it been for just to give an example more on that, Guru Dronacharya was more keen on Arjun. Because of he knew the excellence of bow and arrow and not on Duryodhan of whatever metal he used. Just a concern, wanted a small answer from your side. Why is it still pertaining? Why is only this maths, physics, chemistry, bio numbers are very high and nobody is keen on career interest or aspiration test matching with employability? Thank you.